Patient would like to have a jump of this amount, and the jump of this amount is not permitted. So exactly like in your case, Rico, you had a gap of densities in which equilibrium was not possible. Here we have a gap in the jumps. So which is a strategy? A strategy has already been indicated by you. That is, at this point, we take the energy, and we see that there is no minimum in this case. Okay, we calculate a lower bound, as you said, for your case, and then we try to make a minimizing sequence. And then we see which could be a limit element of this sequence, which is not a classical deformation, okay, with jumps, because we know that this is not. But if this limit has a meaning, that means that we have to enlarge, to complete our configuration space to include that limit. Okay? And this is what we shall do tomorrow. Yeah. Non ti sento, scusami. Yeah. No, the straight line is just to single out this level, and so to single out the part of the curve which is about that level, to say that this part of the curve is not made of equilibrium configuration. No, you are not allowed to take jumps less than this, so your curve is simply this, okay? We will arrive at a sort of fine mixture in the style of Müller, but we have to do some computations for that. Okay, I can stop here. So. Thank you.
And I'll talk today about. I mean, the title is Gibbs Measure and Van der Waals Theory, Van der Waals and not Leonard Jones. So, yesterday we have seen something about zero temperature, where the problem was to minimize the energy for given density. And today we study the
screen, no?
Full screen. Forgot it. It's enough to digit something. And so positive temperatures. So the idea which is behind Boltzmann and Gibbs was to say that unlike at zero temperature where you try to minimize the energy, now you say that even higher values of the energy may be available if because they may be obtained in more ways. So there is, that's what I'm saying. Higher values of the energy may be favored because there are many. So this is the idea. Then there was the Boltzmann hypothesis, which relates the number of states with the same energy to the entropy of that energy. Thermodynamic entropy of that energy, so that the minimization is a balance between energy and entropy. And the factor which enters into the minimization is the temperature, so that we have a free energy F, which is E minus TS. And instead of minimizing the energy, we have to minimize the free energy. That's the idea. So, I mean, this is in the background of the Boltzmann-Gibbs hypothesis, which then are made explicit via the Gibbs formula. So the Gibbs formula is something which says I mean, the first postulate of the theory is that equilibrium states are described by Gibbs measures. Okay, so now it starts with Gibbs measure, and so we leave the study of the energy and we enter into the studies of probabilities. So this is one of the objections that I heard about this school, that there are two courses, it's one and the other, and they are separated. So let me try to convince you that there is a relation. So before, so I stop a moment at this presentation and I try to relate it to what Gian Pietro was doing. Okay, so I'll try to, since I'm playing the part of Gian Pietro, yes, it works. So, so let's say I want to do. No, this is. Say again. What is written? Okay. So. So I'm doing probability, and so I'm considering random variables xi I. So that my xi I, let's say, is the analog of this object that Gian Pietro was considering, which is the displacement. So these are my random variables, functions, and they are more or less related to the displacements that Gian Pietro was considering. Okay, so I take these are random variables with some distribution, and I take. This identical distribution for them, independent. And this corresponds to what Gian Pietro was doing, because he was considering a functional, which was the integral of something of u prime. And so there was no relation between different u prime, because it was a functional of independent things. If there was some u double prime in the functional, then there would be interactions among these xi and would no longer be independent. So in the equilibrium, there is no displacement. So I would say that the expectation of xi I is equal to zero. It means that this displacement is in the average zero. And then the total displacement is the sum of the xi I. And here it was the integral of this. So this is the correspondence. There will be this, I mean, this dx, let me put 1 over n, and I do the sum from 1 to n. OK, so the xi I are independent variables. There is some law of large number or ergodic theorem which says that this sum is in the average zero, which corresponds to the fact that without any strain, the bar is stopped. But
I mean, your analogy. No, it's
I'm recording.
The fluctuation.
These are so these variables are the displacement of the ith piece of the chain around its equilibrium position. No. In the moment it's zero. I've not yet put. No? Okay. Just okay. No. So this Xi I, this sum of Xi I is zero. So it means that that the displacement from the equilibrium is. Then I would put interaction among these. That's what I was saying. So no, but now, what is the problem that Gian Pietro was doing? Okay, so let's try to elongate the bar. So I want to compute the probability that this sum is not zero, but it's larger than zero. Okay, so there is a Kramer theorem, which tells you that the best strategy in order to do this, if you want to make some deviation, is to attribute a same displacement to each one of these. Okay, so if you want to do, so if you want to compute the probability that this sum is of the order of beta, larger than zero, then you can compute this probability by saying that you change the distribution of this Xi I and you make it not longer with average zero, but with a small change of the order of beta. Okay? And this is correct if this Xi I have a finite variance. So if the expectation of Xi I square is finite. So if you wanted to compute this probability, this is exponentially small, and the factor which appears, the leading factor, is the one that you would have if you change this probability into one where each of these variables has an average beta instead. Okay, I mean, another possible strategy would be this one. I mean, this is costly, you know, because you have n variables and and this probability is realized by saying that each of these Xi I's is typically of the order of beta instead of being of the order of zero. Okay. Another possible strategy is to say that one of them is large, of the order of n, and all the others stay around zero. And this is actually what happens if you drop this condition that Xi I square is has a finite expectation. No, so the fracture in this case would be the fact that one of these variables becomes large and all the others are small. And you want to know in which cases, for which probability this happens, and then you, or yeah, and then a question is why one and not two or three or so on. And okay, so if you start in this way, there are, many things that have been done. I mean, this is a very rough introduction to this problem. I mean, there have been, I guess, people like working with Herbert Spohn who have studied particle models where something of this happens, where the fact that you have here in this language, it's one variable that it's very large and all the others stay small. And in the particles language is that on some site you have a blow up of particles, many particles which are there, and then all the others stays, on all other sites you have just a few particles. So, I mean, it's not totally distinct what we are doing with Gibbs measures and probabilities and what Gian Pietro was doing. That's the only thing I wanted to say. Okay, so let's go back to this. So in order to describe the states at positive temperature, one introduces Gibbs measures. So the Gibbs measures, it's actually Gibbs probability, and I will be considering canonical Gibbs measures, which means that the number of particles which are in the box lambda are not random. Okay, so capital N is fixed. I'm here denoting by underline X a configuration, Q1, Qn. Maybe at this stage it's less confusing than using Q as I was doing yesterday. So the state of my system is a probability mu on lambda to the n, and it's given by the formula which is written here. So it's there is a 1 over z, which is a normalization factor. I will write it down in a moment. And then there is the part of the Gibbs measure. So there is dx, which is the Lebesgue measure on lambda to the n. There is a factor e to the minus beta h of x, which is called the Gibbs factor. Beta is 1 over kt, k is the Boltzmann constant, and t is the absolute temperature. And then there is a 1 over n factorial, which enters because I want to consider the particles identical. So, I don't know, I mean, there are several attitudes. I mean, it's nothing very definite. I mean, the way I'm putting it, it's a postulate. So I'm starting from this, and you will judge about its validity from the consequences. There are, however, other approaches which lead to something of this sort. One of them is ergodic theory. Another one goes into information theory. So you, instead of supposing this, you introduce an entropy following Boltzmann, saying that it's the log of the number of states available for a given energy. Then you manipulate this assumption and you get to something of this sort. So it's always a question, I mean, you may start from different postulates and you get more or less to this one. But in any case, you are starting from a postulate. So it's a matter of taste which one you like. I would put it like that. So the normalization factor is the one, is the number z, which makes the measure mu dx a probability. And that's called the canonical partition function. Canonical because I'm fixing the number of particles. I've asked to have some music in order to make this lecture a little testier. I hope you appreciate. Because somebody was protesting, was against. Okay, so free energy. I'm going to talk about free energy. But first, let me say that the n factorial that I've put here in this formula is redundant, because there is an n factorial in mu, and there is an n factorial in z. So they cancel. However, it's convenient to keep it for the reason that will appear in a moment. Another thing is that H, which is the Hamiltonian and the energy, should also contain the kinetic energy T. But this is the dependence on the momenta is trivial, because the kinetic energy is a sum of kinetic energies for each particle. So it's they are independent variables that won't play any role. So I just forgot them. Again, if I integrate over the momenta, they cancel the contribution in mu cancels with the partition function, with the z. So now I'm lazy, so I'm stating another postulate, but it's actually not really independent from the previous one. But let's say, to be on the safe side, I say it's a new postulate. And the new postulate tells me that if I want to compute the free energy when the particle density is rho and the inverse temperature is beta, what I should do is to compute the partition function, that is an integral, which depends on lambda n, and take the log. And then I divide by lambda, which is so that it's an intensive quantity, it's per volume. And I have to divide by beta because I have two. And then I take lambda to infinity and then to infinity in the proper way. And the postulate is that this limit is minus the free energy. The fact that the limit exists is a theorem. The fact that it's equal to the thermodynamical free energy is the postulate. Yeah, n over lambda is going to rho. So one of the great successes of statistical mechanics, this came out around essentially the 60s and the 70s, was that if you use this formula for the free energy, you get an equation of state which is one compatible with thermodynamics. So thermodynamics is well settled in this theory. So if I really able to compute f beta of rho, I have an explicit connection between the Hamiltonian, the microscopic Hamiltonian, so the interaction among particles, and thermodynamic potentials. So in this sense, one has finished, no? Because one has established the connection between microscopic and macroscopics, and what it's left is to do some computation. This was the reason why in the 70s there was a conference we organized in Camerino, and Ruel was one of the founders of this theory and proved most of this statement that I'm doing, said that, okay, statistical mechanics is finished. Now there are computations and I leave them to the youngers. So it's, we have become old doing this computation. Okay, so one thing is, let me go back to the formula, to the Gibbs formula. You see that there is a beta there, e to the minus beta h, and beta is 1 over t. And yesterday we were studying t equals 0, so if I take t to 0, I'm taking beta to infinity. If I take beta to infinity, this measure concentrates on the ground states of h. So we have, in a sense, established the connection between what I was saying yesterday and this one. But the connection is not so nice, actually. Because, what I would really like to prove is this following conjecture. So I want to take t maybe very, very small but positive. And I would like to say that there is a phase transition, which means that there is a forbidden interval. Let me call it rho prime, rho double prime. And then, what should happen is that if I put capital N particle in the box lambda with N over lambda, which is in the forbidden interval, then now you have to put quotation marks for the moment because I don't want to be very explicit, but I will be in the next frame. So a typical configuration should be such that there is a local density again with quotation marks, which is rho prime in some subset and rho double prime in the complement. This is the analog of the phase transition that we were seeing at zero temperature. And moreover, it should happen that this rho prime, rho double prime goes to the, as t goes to zero, goes to what we found at temperature zero. No, so this conjecture is just saying that what happens at temperature zero should happen if the temperature is small enough. Okay, it's in some sort of continuity. I have a phase transition at zero temperature. I will have a similar phase transition with a similar forbidden interval when the temperature is small. Now, this is something we were seeing in the previous lecture. No? Gianpietro had some stability or metastability property, and then this remained valid for small variations. No? Unfortunately, when you talk about phase transition, there is no continuity. No? Because the phase transition, if you remember, in the zero temperature case, means that there is a straight segment. Now, if you perturb something continuously, the curve may be convex and not a straight segment. So convex curve could be arbitrary. I mean, you can approximate straight segment with convex curves arbitrarily well. So that it's not at all clear that if you have something which has a phase transition, something close to it has also a phase transition. And this is the main difficulty in the theory. There is no continuity in this. Okay, so I say that this is a conjecture because it's not proved. So there is no proof of it. There is a proof for lattice gas. That is, if I consider configuration of particles which are not free to move in the old lambda, but they are obliged to stay on a lattice. So at each point of the lattice, let's say CD, I have either zero or one particle. If I consider this case, then phase transition can be proved for quite a general set of interactions. And the reason why it works on the lattice and not in the continuum is really physical. That in the lattice, the kind of perturbation of the ground states can be classified pretty well. This is, they are classified in terms of contours. Contours are the regions which separate one phase from the other. And one has a good control of these contours. There are not too many. If you try to do the same in the continuum, it's a mess because, as you know, in the there are physical effects like fractures, or there are dislocations, or other kind of deformations, which are extremely long range, and make the analysis essentially impossible. So this is the real open question in statistical mechanics: to be able to prove that at small temperature happens something which is close to what happens at zero temperature. So here it's not a question. I mean, I would be very happy to have a proof of this, even for caricatures of the Lennard-Jones potential, something which is R rods plus a small attractive tail, for which proving the zero temperature phase transition is kind of obvious. If you try to do that with these measures, it's complicated. Imagine it's I think so. But maybe we should,
essentially,
Yes, the I mean, in this lattice gas, the zero temperature case, it's one where one state is the empty state and the other one is everything filled up. These are the two extremal states. Now, if you take some positive temperature, let's say the state, the ground state all filled up will no longer filled up. So there will be empty sides. But typically these empty sides will be small islands which are somewhere in the space and very far away from each other. And so one can control them. They are kind of independent variables which appears with very small probabilities. While in the continuum, it's extremely more complicated. Yeah, the lattice, yeah, sure. Sure, I mean, there is, I mean, the, one would expect that the typical configurations are very close to a lattice, a triangular lattice, but then the triangular lattice will be deformed, moving from one part of the space into the other. I think there are general theorems which say that in two dimensions cannot happen, that there is a lattice structure all over. So the Gibbs measure will be automatically translational invariant. I think it's a theorem by Frelich and Pfister. So it's only in three dimension one may hope that there is kind of a crystal structure at positive temperature. But in any case, it will have a lot all the deformations that are studied when you study crystals. I mean, fractures, it's the minimal thing. So let me, so I was saying here, typical configurations, local density. So let me try to say quantitatively what it means. So this was a picture which was appearing already yesterday. So I introduce a priori a sequence of partitions over the scale L, and they are one contained into the other, as in this picture. Okay, then I have to introduce the local density. So let's say the local density on scale L means the following. It's a function of R. R is a point in the space, and measures the number of particles in the configuration underline X which are in the cubes which contains R. So that's the number of particles of the configuration X in the cube, and I divide by the volume. So in this way, I define a function of R, which depends on L, which is the scale on which I'm measuring things, and on the configuration X. And this function in particular is constant in each cube of the partition. So in each cube of the partition, I have defined the density. And I'm taking L pretty large with respect to the typical distance among particles, so that in the cube that I'm considering, there are a lot of particles. Since there are a lot of particles, I may expect that this variable is slowly changing, doesn't have much fluctuations. And then I may look at the good configurations. So the good configurations underline X, which have in total n particles, are those for which in each cube I may attribute either the density rho prime or double prime, so that those cubes which are written here, which are those where I cannot do that, because the empirical density differs from rho prime by more than epsilon, or it differs from rho double prime for more than epsilon. So all these points are a small fraction of the volume. So I have introduced an accuracy parameter, which is epsilon. Epsilon is a small thing. And I'm saying that a good configuration is one where in most of the cubes, I either see rho prime or rho double prime. It means that only in epsilon lambda, volume of lambda of the cubes, I don't see either of them. You look confused, especially Rossana. No, it's only sleeping. Okay. So this is the good set. And then the conjecture says that the canonical Gibbs measure gives a large probability to this set. Okay, so this is a conjecture for, as I said, for the continuum particle, but it's a proof, it's proved for the lattice gas. No, there is L, so that. So given an accuracy epsilon, I'm choosing coarse grain, which is very large. In this coarse grain, I see most of the cubes with the right density. Okay, so this is a mathematically precise condition, and as Ruel was saying, it's only a matter of proving. No, actually, there was a conference organized by Joe Leibovitz in Rutgers in 2000 in honor of Sinai and Ruel, and each one of them had to propose to the other some question for the next century. And this was the question that Sinai asked, Ruel asked Sinai, because Sinai is an expert in, I mean, the Pirogov-Sinai theory is a theory which has been developed for lattice gases or for spin systems in order to study perturbation of ground states. So this was one of the questions of Ruel. I mean, since you have done this for the for the lattice, why don't you do it also for the particles? Okay, so let's go. You remember that in the first frame I was saying about the Boltzmann and Gibbs ideas and the fact that there was this Boltzmann idea of definition of entropy, which is encoded into the Gibbs formula. So let's see why is that. So the Gibbs probability that I've defined before was the Gibbs probability of finding a volume element dx in the phase space. Now, with that probability, I may try to compute what's the probability to find an energy dE. So in order to do this, I have to integrate over all configurations which have the energy dE, and I'm getting something like that. So 1 over z was the factor. E to the minus beta e was it's the Gibbs factor, it's constant, because I'm integrating over the small, the infinitesimal element d, and then I'm getting something d, well, capital D e is the density with energy e. So, I mean, if one wants to really do it quantitatively, has to make some assumption on the energy. One has, for instance, to suppose that the gradient of H is away from zero, and then one can integrate over the energy surface, and D comes out to be the integral over the surface energy with the surface area, D sigma, of the gradient of H, 1 over gradient of H. This is called the co-area formula, I guess, by mathematicians. It will certainly be in the Things for Beginners of Andrea Breides. Confirm. So the Boltzmann hypothesis says that the dE that I've seen before, if I take the log and multiply by kappa, is the entropy, the thermodynamical entropy. No? So I had, so dE now I'm writing as an exponential, and I'm getting this formula. And so we see that what really, okay, now, let's go on. So I'm interested in large volume. So I'm saying that my energy E, capital E, will be the energy density times the volume. My entropy S will be the entropy density times the volume. And then the Gibbs formula becomes this. So I have this expression. I just changed names, but I've done nothing. But here it's the interesting point, that if lambda is large, the term beta lambda becomes large. So I'm not supposing that beta is large. It's enough to say that lambda is large, the volume is large. And this is suggesting that I have to look for the minimizers of E minus TSE, which is the free energy. No? So that's why taking lambda to infinity is called thermodynamic limit. Because in this limit, I discovered that that the measure gets supported by the inf of the free energy, which is the thermodynamic principle. So in this way, there is a connection. So all this is very clear. Unfortunately, the big difficulty is that we don't know how to control S of E, because I have to compute the volume of an energy surface, the area of an energy surface. And this is difficult because all particles are interacting. There are capital N particles, and capital N is going to infinity. And you have to know what's, to have a control of this area, and you don't know actually. So here is where we stop. So for lattice gases, can more or less be done, but in the continuum it's very difficult. So this is where one has to do something more, so to change a little the model in order to proceed. I mean, from a theoretical conceptual point of view, everything is fixed. I mean, I just have to compute integrals, but it's very difficult to do that. So an extreme simplification is the van der Waals theory, which is related to mean field. So now I'm not really historically correct. I mean, I'm adapting the van der Waals and then the Katz theory in a way which is useful for my purposes. So it's essentially correct, but not literally correct, what I'm saying. So the mean field assumption is this one, that the energy is a function of the density. No, so it's a very, very big assumption. Makes life very easy, because then it's much easier to compute the volume of an energy surface, because I have just to count the number of configurations with some given number of particles. Okay, let's specify more this mean field. So energy is a function of rho, and let's say van der Waals, typical van der Waals assumption is that this energy is over lambda, over the volume, so the energy density is a function of rho, and in particular is minus j rho square. So j is a positive number, and rho square is rho square. So this is a negative interaction. This rho square reminds us that it's typically the number of pairs, because n square is the number of pairs. So this is kind of assumption that the energy, this energy is the contribution of the long attractive tail of the interaction. And this is kind of compatible with mean field, because the long tail is slowly varying, and so it's not very sensitive to where the particles actually are. So this assumption of mean field and writing the energy of this actually takes into account only the long part of the interaction. So it would be wrong to suppose that that the repulsive interaction among particles is really taken into account by this formula. I mean, this is only taking into account the negative part. So in some sense, there must, van der Waals has to add some other assumption about the repulsive interaction. On the other hand, it's obvious that this doesn't work because you see, the energy per particle, so you have to divide by rho, becomes minus j rho, which is unbounded. No? So with this energy assumption, the matter would not be stable, because one would like to have infinite densities, because that would be the minimizer of the energy. So the second assumption of van der Waals is to bound the particle's density. So if I say that the density is bounded, then I don't have any longer this problem of stability. So this is done in a very crude way by van der Waals, because he supposes that each particle is not a point, but it's, let's say, a sphere, which occupies a volume that I call A. So that and particles cannot penetrate each other. So if there are n particles, they occupy a volume n times A, which means that capital N can be at most lambda volume over A, and so it's bounded. So rho is equal to N over lambda must be smaller than A to the minus one. So this is settled. There is a problem, however, because in doing this, it's again difficult to compute the volume available to the system. So van der Waals made a second assumption, that is that since there are capital N particle and each one occupies a volume A, there is a free volume left, which is the total volume minus NA. Okay, then he says that each particle can stay independent, I mean, in this van der Waals assumption, each particle can stay independently of any other in this free volume. So it's kind of a contradictory assumption, but let's make it. So in this way, I can compute the entropy, S of rho, which is k times the log, and the log is 1 over n factorial, because it was there in the definition of the measure, and then I have to integrate over the free volume, each particle, so it's, this is wrong, I should have written the volume of lambda minus NA to the N. It's contradictory because, I mean, you make happy van der Waals because because he was trying to convince you that this is correct. No, now the point is that if I have a capital N spheres, I have to compute what's the volume they occupy. They are not independent of each other. No, but I say that the total volume left is lambda minus NA, and then I say it's like having each particle which moves in that volume independent of the other. But it's not true. So actually, this happens to be true in one dimension, but it's kind of a strange fact. So this is one of the exercises that. Let's proceed with the van der Waals theory. So I have the energy E of rho, because it's by definition. I have S now as a function of rho, which is the one. I divide by lambda, and I compute the free energy. Wonderful. Okay, so I do it. There was, in this S of rho, you see there was an N factorial. This N factorial, N is a large number, I use Stirling. And then I end up with terms with rho log rho. And the free energy, if beta is large at least, comes out to have something of this form. Okay? So this is telling us that van der Waals' theory is wrong, because the thermodynamical free energy must be convex. And this is not. So the last hypothesis in van der Waals' theory is that this f beta of rho that I've written is not the free energy, but the true free energy is the convex envelope. And this is called the Maxwell equal area rule, and says that the free energy of the system is the one where I convexify this. Should say that the Maxwell equal area rule comes out from that one in this form. You define lambda as the derivative with respect to rho of the free energy. This is, in thermodynamics, it's called the chemical potential. So this is the chemical potential as a function of rho. And the law of thermodynamics says that lambda is an increasing function. And you see that it's increasing in the convex parts of the of this curve, but not everywhere. And in fact, lambda as a function of rho for the f beta that we have found has this kind of shape. Now Maxwell says, okay, I want it increasing. So what I do is I take a straight line and then do not follow the curve, but I follow the curve and then the straight line and then again the curve. And then it remains to say, where do I put the curve, the segment? And Maxwell's rule was that you have to balance the two areas. So you put it in such a way that the area up and the area down are the same. So it's a theorem that doing this, it's like a convexifying F beta. So this is the equal. Okay, this is that. So my last transparency for this part was to underline the weak points in the theory. So the weak points are this one, that first of all, the energy depends on the volume, because there is a factor 1 over the energy is minus rho square. So the energy shouldn't depend on the should always be the same. The energy of a particle configuration should have a definite form. Here, instead, I'm changing the energy of the configuration according to where the configuration is in which box I'm considering. Then there was the thing that Mario was asking, that the way van der Waals is computing the phase space volume is wrong. So this has to be settled. And then a third thing is that we found a free energy which is not convex, and then we say, okay, let's make it convex by convexifying. So why is that? I mean, this is should come from inside the theory, not from outside. So these are the weak points of the theory. And why do I underline the weak points? Not for masochistic reasons, but because this justifies why, what we should do in order to improve the theory. So this is what, it's the argument of the other thing. So. Before Mario asks me, they were very well understood, the weak points of the theories in the moment when the statistical mechanics, rigorous statistical mechanics, was formulated, and it was in the 60s, was Katz actually, who posed explicitly the problem of deriving van der Waals theory from within statistical mechanics. So he said, okay, let's try to get the conclusion of van der Waals, but by looking at some specific statistical mechanics model with energies which are well defined and so on. So this was Katz's program. And the way it goes is that it was successful, but only partially, because he was able to find the van der Waals free energy, and actually the van der Waals free energy after convexification. So convexification was inside the theory, was not an external object. But in order to do that, he had to make a scaling limit. And this we will see it's the weak point of the Katz theory. The scaling limit is, I will describe it explicitly in a moment, but just to make understood, it's something where he considers interactions which have very long range, longer and longer. As he scales, the range becomes larger. So in order to have a finite interaction, then the strength of the potential gets smaller. In a very specific way, I will say, in a moment. And I was saying, I mean, the big success is that in this way they were able to prove Katz, Uhlenbeck and Emmer, and then Leibovitz and Penrose, and then many others, that the Maxwell equal area rule can be derived. It's not from nowhere. And people who really made the Katz program available and handable, let's say, were Leibovitz and Penrose. And Leibovitz and Penrose understood that Katz ideas are very much related to coarse graining and renormalization group. So these are things which are important in statistical mechanics. Okay. So in this way, we will go into effective Hamiltonian and free energy functionals. So at this point, there will be a connection with the other part of the lectures. The point here is that a natural way to analyze this Gibbs measure will be to introduce energy functionals. And so we will relate probability estimates to variational problems. So this is this is the typical problem of when people of different sectors meet each other. It's a scaling problem. I mean, you are considering macroscopic units, so that the interparticle distance is very small. I'm considering my unit is the angstrom, so the macroscopic distance is huge. So my large scale amounts to say that in your language it's a very small scale. No, because for me it's large with respect to micro, but will be small with respect to macro. So in your units it's small. Now the fact that I'm saying that the energy vanishes and you are saying that the energy diverges, it's also they are also compatible, because I'm saying that what is vanishing is the interaction energy between two molecules, and you are saying that what is very large is the interaction between two pieces of materials which contains a lot of molecules, because your point it's an infinite. No, so it's all these things are compatible. I mean, maybe going on, you I mean, I will say more about this, but I mean, it are not different limits, are the same limits. So the other point I wanted to stress is that once we introduce free energy functionals, we are connected. I mean, we naturally fall into variational problems, and the peculiar fact of the Katz and Leibowitz and Perros theory is that these variational problems are not with functional like Ginzburg-Landau, where there are in the functional terms which involve derivatives, gradients. Here, the gradients are replaced by non-local terms. So it's they are very similar in structure, but the differences are technically serious. And so it's, I mean, I've seen that because I've interacted with people working in variational problems. From them, I learned what I'm saying. And I mean, there were similarities, but not straightforward. And so it's very nice to have, I mean, to be able to change with physically interesting models some theory. So what's the idea of Katz? Again, it's I'm telling you something in my language, not in Katz language. So it's so in this sense, it's a free adaptation of Katz ideas. So one of the things which was wrong in van der Waals' theory was that the energy, I was saying, the first postulate was that the energy is a function of the total density. So one way to relax this and to make it more appealing is to say that the energy is defined in terms of local, I mean, the energy density depends on the local density. That's what I'm going to. So first of all, I introduce energy density E of rho. So this is something arbitrary. I choose, I mean, in defining the model, I choose, the first thing is to introduce this E of rho, for instance, as in van der Waals. So E of rho may be minus J rho square. Then I have to introduce a local particle density. So I have a configuration that now I denote by Q. In the previous slides, I was calling it underline X. Now I call it Q. So I define, given Q, I define a local particle density that I call rho of R and Q. I will say later what it's this one. And then I define the Hamiltonian in this way. So this is the recipe for defining the energy. So I'm not starting by telling you what's the interparticle potential, but I do this procedure. I introduce first an energy density E of rho, then I define a local density particles rho of r, which depends on q, and then the energy is the integral of the energy density, where I compute the energy density at the point r by computing the local particle density rho. Yeah, I mean, in order to recover the van der Waals, I would say that rho of r and q, the local particle density is actually the total particle density. So it doesn't depend on r. And then the integral becomes lambda times e of rho. So I've just localized van der Waals. So it seems the natural thing to do, even though Katz didn't present it in this way. I think it's nicer to put it in this form. Okay. So E of rho, I now write it in this form. So it's minus alpha. I was calling capital J before. Now I'm calling it alpha. Because Leibovitz and Perros use alpha. Yes. And then I put also a linear term, which is minus lambda rho. So I'm including the chemical potential inside the energy. This is not essential. Okay, so again, as in van der Waals, we are in trouble because this energy defined in this way, it's not stable. It's not stable because there is this rho square which wins against everything. So in order to make it stable, we again follow van der Waals, and so we say that there is an hardcore interaction. So particles cannot be closer than capital R. Okay, so in this way it's well defined, but we are not doing what van der Waals was doing, that is to compute volumes in the way it did. So we keep this as, and so we have completely defined the model, not because we have, the energy is this one, where E of rho is quadratic, and particles configuration are restricted by this constraint. Okay, now we enter into the definition of the local density. So I have to define rho of r and q in order to complete the definition. So this, I say, it's the sum which is written before. So I introduce a kernel J gamma, which depends on two variables, R and R prime, and I compute that sum. So if I think that... So I have defined H of Q in this way.
Rho is a
function of R which depends on Q. So I go only to define this rho. So this rho of R and Q, I define it in this way. So it's J gamma is a kernel which is written in the second line. For the moment, don't read it. So it's that sum. And that sum I may interpret it as the convolution of J gamma with a measure, which is a sum of Dirac delta at the points Qi. So if I think of the configuration Q as a sum of deltas where the particles are, rho of R and Q is the convolution of this kernel J gamma with this measure Q. Now the kernel J gamma, I want it to be a probability kernel. Okay? So this is the empirical density of Q around R weighted with the kernel J gamma. No? I mean, if the kernel J gamma was constant in a ball and then zero, it would be just the number of particles which are in the ball. But I don't want to do that for technical reasons, and it's better to keep a kernel J gamma. So this J gamma is a probability kernel, which depends on the parameter gamma. And this is the scaling I was referring before. So with this gamma, by varying gamma, I make the kernel of this J very large or very small. So you see in the first equality, J gamma is a function J computed at position gamma R prime. Okay, so suppose that J R prime is something of this sort. So J R prime is translational invariant. Okay, so it only depends on the difference between R prime and R. And it's something of this sort. So it's something which is zero outside the unit ball. And inside the unit ball is some smooth kernel. So J is supported by the unit ball. So you see J gamma of R prime is zero if the two arguments are a distance larger than one, which means that R and R prime must be a distance larger than gamma minus one, because are multiplied by gamma. And since gamma is small, this means that points R and R prime are related even if they are far away. They may be far away as much as gamma minus one and still there is an influence. Okay, but I wanted to have a probability kernel. No? So if J without gammas is a probability kernel, then in order for J gamma to be a probability kernel, I have to multiply J by gamma to the D. So that by scaling, I get the same integral. No, actually, in Katz's proposal, it was an exponentially decaying. That's essentially the same. It's, for instance, Lello and Rossana are now working on something where this J must be reflection positive, whatever it means from, and this reflection positive that doesn't work if it's compactly supported. So, I mean, one place. I mean, for the purposes of my. I mean, for what I'm doing, it's better to make it compactly supported. But there are other instances where it's better to have another thing. Yeah, I mean, one tries to avoid all, as much as possible difficulties. So if at some point it's better to have something which is infinite range, I switch right away. Okay, I do something more and then I stop. I mean, I want to tell you what's the result, and I don't want to enter into. Okay, so this is the way I presented it, and I mean, it sounds not so nice, no? Because by my Hamiltonian was this one with the rho that I said, and while usually Hamiltonians are defined in terms of pair interaction. So now I want to show you that what I've done so far, it's actually can be interpreted in terms of pair interactions. This works fine. Choice of particle density. So why is that? So H of Q was that integral. You see, I didn't have to go backwards. So when I prepared my frames, I was more careful than. I've repeated the definition of H of Q. and I've repeated the definition of E of rho, so I can make it this explicit, and the claim is that what I'm getting is this expression. So the H of Q that it's written in the on the first line is the same as this sum, where you notice there is lambda prime and not lambda. So this is something unfortunate, but no, but it is. So what is V of gamma? V of gamma is this this expression. You see, I have E of rho, which is a square. So I make explicit the rho, which is there, and I'm getting for one of them this expression, and for the other this one. And then I collect things together, because I had to do the integral over the R, and this is what I define big M, and so I'm getting this expression. Why the lambda prime? No, it's this one. There is a sum there over I and J.
Okay.
So that sum is J gamma R Q I sum over I. So this is one rho. And the other is the sum over J of this one. Then I fix I and J and integrate over R and get this term. And then I'm left with the case where I and J are equal. This is not contained in the potential, but this is a chemical potential there. So lambda prime is not lambda, but there is this extra term. So this this thing, it's I mean, this was the way Van Katz was presenting the thing. I mean, he was not defining the energy the way I did, but was starting from a big gamma, and actually a specific form of gamma, which was an exponential Ayukawa potential. So that was the V gamma that one may say I may start directly with the V gamma, but there is a particular thing here which is relevant, and that's the fact that this potential that I obtained, this pair potential, it's not completely arbitrary, because it's a positive operator, because it's a square. You see, it's a convolution of two kernels, of the same kernel. So it's J square. The pair interaction V gamma is a positive definite. And Katz didn't have such an assumption. So the theory I'm presenting is a particular one. It's not really Katz. And also, the difference between lambda prime and lambda is irrelevant in the limit, because one is considering gamma to zero. So I will finish by... No, that's too long. I wanted... If somewhere I've written the theorem, no. Yeah. Okay, let me present you this frame, and then tomorrow I will come back to all this part. So what Leibovitz and Penrose have proved is this theorem, let's read it here, that now I can take, you remember that the log of the partition function over beta lambda was minus the free energy. This was postulate number two I was putting in the previous slides. So what Leibovitz and Penrose proved is that if you take the finite volume free energy, which is minus 1 over beta lambda the log, and you take the limit as lambda goes to infinity, and then you get the free energy, then you take gamma to zero. And what they have proved is that all this is some C, which is the convexified free energy of the van der Waals theory. Okay. So tomorrow we will see how we can complete the loop. So we have, following Katz, we have defined a particle model which is all right. And in the end, we will see that we really get what we wanted, that is the convexified free van der Waals free energy. But we need to take the limit lambda to infinity, but also gamma to zero. Okay, and then in the other lectures, final lectures that I will give, will be to consider cases where we do not send gamma to zero. So that at that point, we really have a model which is a finite range interacting system, which presents phase transition. So this will require some extra changing again a little the model, and we will proceed. I think I can stop here. I didn't make any. So if you have some questions, otherwise. Yeah. Yeah, because when I play with the theory, I mean I will end up with a free energy functional, and this free energy functional will be defined on functions which live on a finite volume, and I will have to find the minimizers of this functional. So the minimizers of this functional will depend on the boundary condition that I put on the thing. So if I say that it's a torus, then I can prove that the minimizers are constant functions. That's you see at some point that f of rho will be functional on functions rho which are in lambda with positive value, and the result will be the inf of something which is on a single variable. Yeah. So it's I mean, the theory doesn't require, I mean, that the fact that I take for lambda torus is to make the life easy, but can be proved also with other boundary conditions. So if there are no other questions, thank you very much.